May I have that back, Annie? Thank you. And just to clarify, if you see this lying out, I'm still using it, so you don't have to take it to the kitchen, dump it out, and wash the bowl.
Is this about your buttered noodles?
I didn't say that.
I'm broke, too, so I was going to make him dinner tonight.
Cool. Double date. Dinner and 1993 interactive VCR game. What are you making?
Salmon. Buttered noodles.
Buttered noodles are my favorite.
Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to Binging with Babish, where this week we're returning to the land of Community to take a look at buttered noodles. Now, something that you might not know about me that Abed and I have in common is that I love buttered noodles. I mean, come on, you got your noodles, you got your butter, and when the two come together, what's not to like? Like most of us, I grew up eating them as a child, but the love never went away, and I've gotten pretty good at it. But today, we're not just mixing noodles and butter, we're gonna try to take it to another level. Last week's episode rightly drew comparisons to the work of Claire Saffitz. So this week, I'm gonna go all BuzzFeed on your ass, and we're gonna try to make three different versions of buttered noodles. One that takes 5 minutes, one that takes 15 minutes, and one that takes 5 hours. Times five, minus one, so 24 hours. First up, the version that you're probably picturing in your head when I say buttered noodles. Some lightly salted water brought to a boil, some egg noodles dumped into it, the noodles cooked per manufacturer's directions. Once tender, the noodles removed from the heat, drained, sometimes tragically rinsed with tap water, returned to the pot, and mixed together with butter and salt. Maybe some ground black pepper if you're trying to evoke memories of your high school cafeteria. Mixed until the butter is melted and the seasonings dispersed throughout. Served either on its lonesome or as a base for other more flavorful dishes like pot roasts. And you're not going to hear me complain about this. This is what I grew up eating. It's buttered noodles. I like it. And now you're probably wondering, how is he going to jazz this up? Is he going to add Parmesan, as is so often suggested by online recipes? And the answer is no. If you add Parmesan to buttered noodles, you do not have buttered noodles anymore, my guy. You have a bitter, half-assed cacio e pepe. The problem with these noodles lies not in its simplicity, but in the bottom of the bowl, or the bottom of the pot, which you can see is slick with a sort of greasy, clarified butter. This is why you might think of buttered noodles as oily and bland. So where do we start with the improvements? First off, the pasta itself. Ooh, we got ourselves a pasta drum solo going here. Somebody's seen Whiplash one too many times. But also a comparison of two common supermarket pastas. One of the many kitchen categories where you get what you pay for. Inexpensive pasta tends to be sort of smooth and shiny. It's cheaply made, so it has less texture and less flavor. Higher end pastas tend to look more like this. They have roughed up, textured exteriors indicating that they've been cut with a bronze dye. It's also likely, I apologize for my cuticles, I haven't been able to get a manicure in a while. This rough exterior and the slow drying process usually utilized in making gourmet pasta all translate to a better, tastier product, which is very important when we're making a dish with two ingredients. The other, of course, being butter. On the right, we have an unsalted bargain supermarket stick, and on the left, we have a fancy schmancy European block. Gourmet butter, just like pasta, can often cost twice as much as its less expensive counterparts. Can this extravagance really be worth it? The answer is yeah, big time. Bargain butter kind of tastes like pure plain fat, whereas the good stuff can taste sweet and tangy and grassy. There are a great many peoples that make beautiful, flavorful butter. And my top picks have got to go to Europeans, New Englanders, and blood of my blood, upstate New Yorkers. Not only does this butter taste great, it looks better. It's a golden yellow, indicating that it came from a happy, tasty, grass-fed cow. So let's put it to good work. You'll notice that I have a different shaped cooking vessel this time around. It's not totally necessary to utilize an oval-shaped Dutch oven, but it is spaghetti-shaped. So no more awkward maneuvering to get all the spaghetti down into the water. You'll also notice that I'm using a lot less water. That's because I want the water to get extra starchy. Right when the pasta's done, I'm gonna grab about a half cup of it, set it aside, drain the pasta, return it, unwashed, to the still warm pot, add some of our delicious unsalted butter courtesy of upstate New York, about a quarter cup of our reserve pasta water, and a generous pinch of kosher salt. Then give it a very rigorous stir. Just like finishing the sauce for any pasta, we want the butter to emulsify with the pasta water, which, instead of an oily mess, is going to give us a nice creamy sauce. And doesn't that sound nicer than buttered noodles anyway? Pasta in butter sauce, or pasta al burro, as the Italians call it. Either way, it's time to tuck into your bowl of better buttered noodles. I know these tips seem kind of obvious and simple, but we're talking about an obvious and simple dish here, and the only things that are going to elevate it are the simple things. I know it doesn't show up super well on camera, but it is straight up creamy, almost like it has a cream sauce or cheese sauce on it. You can scoff if you want, but it's the same reason that people say their favorite food is bread and butter. When the simple things are done right, it just hits different. The only way we could possibly improve on that would be to make everything from scratch. So here we go. Now, I've made butter from scratch on this show before. Click the link in the upper right-hand corner if you want to see that. But the problem is, I can't make better butter than these Frenchies. What I can do is culture their butter by making some creme fraiche. Here I am combining 4 cups of heavy cream with a half cup of cultured buttermilk. Tiny whisking to combine, covering and letting sit out at room temperature for 24 hours. 24 hours later, and it would seem like the only thing that's changed is my shirt. But looks can be deceiving. Let's give this a wiggle, shall we? Huh? As you can see, the culture from the buttermilk has thickened our heavy cream into a delicious, tangy soft serve known as creme fraiche. You could just put this stuff in a stand mixer or a food processor and beat it into butter all on its own, but I'm going to add an equal part of room temperature European butter and whip together until all the milk fats separate from the newly minted buttermilk. Should only take about 15 seconds. And with that, we are left with a new butter, one with all the flavor of the European stuff and an added acidic tang from our creme fraiche. Once you've got your lump of butter, you need to wash it in ice water 4 or 5 times until the water squeezed out of the butter runs clear. Then just squeeze out all the water you can, and this guy is ready for the fridge, and that's exactly where it's headed. We need cold butter to emulsify our sauce. Now onto the pasta. I want to capture the essence of that really good butter, really good sourdough eating experience. So I'm making an egg-based pasta out of about 80% 00 flour and about 20% rye flour, which is going to bring some of those nutty peasant loaf vibes. That's about 16 total ounces of flour, 2 teaspoons of kosher salt, and 3 large eggs, at first beaten into the flour with a fork and then kneaded for 8 to 10 minutes. And then this guy's going in either a zip-top bag or plastic wrap for 30 minutes to rest before rolling and cutting. You could do this by hand, but if you have a pasta roller, it's obviously much easier not only to roll it out, but to laminate it. The essential gluten-building process of rolling out, folding in thirds, and rolling out again 3 to 4 times. Then rolling out thinner and thinner until you've reached your desired thickness and cutting into fettuccine, which, in order to prevent kinky pasta, we're not going to fold, but rather drape into a nest, placing on a floured baking sheet and keeping covered and refrigerated until ready to cook, then placing again into a small amount of boiling water, and as it cooks for about 1.5 minutes, you can see there's a saute pan that I'm keeping warm on the side, not hot. I just want it warm enough that the pasta and the water and the butter do not cool off when I transfer them over. You could also use a large bowl that you've kept warm with boiling water, because our objective here is to combine our pasta, cultured butter, a little bit of pasta water, and kosher salt, and to toss everything together vigorously so as to aerate and emulsify the sauce, which by virtue of the speckled pasta is going to show you just how creamy this sauce gets. It's almost starting to look like an Alfredo. Go ahead and plate this however you like. I'm going to twist it into a little nest that I'm going to transfer over to a warm plate using a ladle carving fork combo. I'm going to top with a little dollop of our creme fraiche, and to really drive home the sourdough and butter eating experience, I'm going to steal a page from Riccardo Camanini's cookbook and top the pasta with a little bit of shaved fresh brewer's yeast, which is a little sweet, a little tangy, and dissolves on the tongue. That, along with a few twists of freshly ground black pepper, and folks, I think we got ourselves a winner here. This dish is creamy, nutty, sweet, tangy, earthy, buttery, rich, and toothsome. It is delicious. Is it worth all the extra effort? Debatable. As said before, this is a simple dish with simple ingredients and simple flavors, so when it's done right, it's a member of the Clean Plate Club and a dish worth rocking out over.